We should all be so proud to be the UAW because we have an unbelievable friend who's joined us here today. It is so important to have leaders in government who really believe that the government should serve 100% of the people, not just 1% of the people. It's so important to have leaders who believe that we all rise higher when we all rise together. It's so important to have leaders who believe in America, believe in investing in America workers, in high tech, in apprenticeship programs, and skill building. We have a friend in Vice President Joe Biden who's stood up for us in every single fight we've been in. He was one of our strongest advocates in the auto industry. He's been a strong, strong advocate for rebuilding manufacturing in the United States. When we've been in fights in gaming and higher ed and aerospace and ag imp, in defense, everywhere we represent people, our friend and ally, Vice President, has been there with us. I want you to give the greatest UAW welcome to one of the strongest advocates, allies, and friends the UAW has ever had, our great Vice President Joe Biden.
Hello, UAW. It's good to be home. And you guys are home for me. Bob, thank you for that introduction. And all of you who work with Bob know you have a built-in excuse when you're late. You can say, the president made me late. But I do apologize. The National Security meeting, as you all saw, but it really did run over. I apologize, although probably had I said, Mr. President, I have to go speak to the UAW, he would have said it's okay to leave. But folks, it's great, great to be here. Mary Beth, how are you doing, kid? It's good to see you. I just want to know that, where's Mike Kavanaugh and Richard Mark? My Delaware guys. I knew you'd stand up first, Peaches. I knew it'd be you. I tell you what, we're smaller in number in Delaware, but we are still there. We are still there. You know, there's an old expression in my neighborhood, you go home with them that brung you to the dance. Now, I was saying that, I told my staff I was going to say that, and they're much younger, and they say, don't you want to say you want to dance with those that brought you to the dance? And I said, why? I said, well, taking them home, that has a connotation. I said, not when I was a kid. It meant taking you back to the door you took you from. But that's a different story, you know. It's like I said to my granddaughter as a sophomore at Penn, I said, yeah, sounds like a broken record. She said, Pop, what's a record? But at any rate, think about that for a minute. You know, try it with your kids. But look, you brought me to the dance in 1972, and that's not a joke. Richard Nixon was at the top of the ticket. He was a dead lead pipe cinch to win my state. And everybody thinks my state's always been blue. When I started off, my state was red. 5 out of 8 races were won by Republicans in my state. It wasn't blue. But the folks who helped make it blue were the UAW. Back in those days, we had about 9,000 UAW workers in my little state of Delaware. You were the largest union in my state. We had the two of the largest plants outside of Detroit, General Motors plant and Chrysler plant. And when everything was down, I was losing 56-17 on Labor Day, of that year, with Nixon at the top of the ticket. And you guys endorsed me. You guys endorsed me. And I mean this sincerely. Everything became changed. Then the steel workers jumped in, and all the labor. But you led the way. You were the ones that took a bet on me. You've never left me, and I've never left you. So thank you. I can honestly say, I would not be standing here without you. That's the God's truth. And folks, I still know how to pronounce the word union. Union. One of our problems is not enough elected officials remember how to pronounce the word union. Everybody talks about workers. I talk about unions. Because every worker in America, whether or not they've been a member of a union since the National Labor Relations Act in the 30s, since you guys started speaking up, since in that fight at the bridge in 1937, the Battle of the Overpass, since that date, since that time, starting back in my hometown of Scranton with the mine workers and with you guys in the 30s, here's the deal. Everybody forgets this. Every other worker, white collar and blue collar, not a union member, has figured out the reason they had benefits in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s was because of organized labor. Every company in America changed their work rules, raised salaries, moved in the direction of better conditions for workers because you were there. That's a fact. That's a fact. At the time, back in my little state of Delaware, was then a right-to-work law, the folks at the DuPont Company and all the other big corporations, the employees, they didn't think that was the case. But all of a sudden, when things started going south, and all of a sudden the loyalty they thought they had from all of the companies that they worked for, all of a sudden, it changed. And all of a sudden, if you look back, it corresponded with the declines of American labor as a percentage of the workforce in America. Back in 1972, when I ran, there was over 30% of the American workforce was labor. Today, I don't have to tell you the story. It's a whole lot less. I brought along, you can't see it here, but I brought along a little graph. And I'm going to leave it, and you may make copies of it. You maybe already have it. It says, union membership rates decrease, middle class income shrinks. When we started back in 67, it was 28% of all the folks in America belonged to organized labor. And you saw the share of the income the middle class was receiving. And as union membership dropped and declined, the share of income earned by Americans in the middle class began to decrease. Guys, it's not an exaggeration. I know I've been saying it for a long time, and everybody, and you've been saying it. People go, oh, yeah, that's, I get it. But the truth of the matter is, you built the middle class. Labor built the middle class. And there's a reason why the middle class is shrinking. I know I got in trouble for saying this before, but I'm going to say it again. You guys are the only guys keeping the barbarians at the gate, man. That's the deal. And I'm going to say something else, because, you know, you've never doubted what I say, I mean. The problem is I sometimes say all that I mean. But the truth is, the other entity out there that's keeping this thing a little bit in check, besides organized labor, are trial lawyers. Trial lawyers are the only guys taking on these major, major corporations. They're afraid of them. You may not like them. I know everybody calls them bottom feeders and all this other stuff, but the truth of the matter is, they're the reason why their product safety standards are where they are in a long way. Because the price they pay for being shoddy, not doing their work, is they got to face these guys. Look at the tobacco industry. I can go down the list. So guys, look, because unions were growing stronger, corporations many times avoided unionizations, increased working conditions, increased salaries, provided additional benefits. In addition, the thing about you all that I can say about no other group in America, you not only fought for the issues that affected your salary and wages and hours, but every single time, something good had to be done. Every single time, even though it didn't directly affect your members, you guys have stood up You stood up. You stood up for working class people. It didn't affect you. The minimum wage never has been an issue with you all. You've always made more than the minimum wage. But you go out there and you throw yourself in front of the bus to make sure people get a minimum wage. You go out there and you fought back in 1972. The single biggest force for environmental change in my state was the UAW. You go out and you fight for things that affect the people from the neighborhoods we come from. The neighborhoods we come from. That's the incredible thing about you. That's one of the reasons I love you so much. Not just you, but labor generally. You never leave anybody behind, even when it costs you politically. And it doesn't benefit you directly. That's a remarkable thing. Occupational safety, minimum wages, extending unemployment benefits. You know, all these things, though, began to change in the 80s and the 90s. Certain elements in American business, led by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and National Right to Work Committees, they launched a full-throated effort to erode a principle that was established as part of the American ethic in the 30s, collective bargaining. That became their target. Collective bargaining. As I said to you in 2008, when I was seeking another job in front of you all, we all were coming before you, I remember I got criticized by the press. I said, let's understand one thing. They've waged a war on labor's house. This is a concerted, full-throated, well-organized, well-financed, well-thought-out, long-term effort, waging a war on labor's house, because they know, not all business, these guys on the right, they know without you there, they call every shot. I mean this sincerely. I think sometimes you guys underestimate it. And guess what? They've been very successful. Look what's happened in Michigan and Indiana and 22 other right-to-work states. When I got elected, we were changing the other way. We're eliminating right-to-work states, including mine. Now, just like I never thought I'd have to go back and refight the Voting Rights Act, I never thought I'd be back refighting after all this time in my career, the wave of right-to-work efforts, the right to pay you a lower wage, the right to make sure you don't have a say in your working conditions. It's not a right to work. It's a right for them to eliminate your right to have a say in your work. And look at the efforts currently underway. The efforts underway to pass right to work. Do you ever think you'd see a day when right to work would pass in Michigan?
No.
Come on, guys. Come on. Look what's happening now in the industrial states when we were coming up. Ohio, Pennsylvania, Missouri. Look at Harris v. Quinn, the case before the Supreme Court. There's a hell of a lot at stake, folks. The National Right to Work Committee is arguing that public sector unions don't have the right to collect fees from non-members, even for non-political activities. This is a potential to drastically weaken the bargaining power of public unions in America. The President and I, through the Solicitor General, came in on the side of the unions in an oral argument and filing an amicus brief, because we know that collective bargaining is the bedrock of our economy. It's not just about you. It's not just about you. It's about economic growth. As I said, in 1968, union membership rate was 28%. Middle class share of the income of all income was 53%. Now union membership is 11% combined, and middle class only gets 45% of the pie. Folks, the bottom line is, it's hard to live a middle class life without a decent paying job that pays a living wage. You know? And I love today all these corporate types and right-to-work types who talk about, the right of business in America. Henry Ford, there was no more hard-headed, sharp-edged businessman than Henry Ford. But why did Henry Ford, I think it was 1970, why did he double the salary for line workers to $5? We can argue it was out of the bottom of the goodness of heart. Maybe it was, but guess what? He understood basic economics. He understood that when people get paid more, the economy grows more, more products get bought, the rich get richer, and the poor have a way up. The results were clear for Henry Ford. Within a year of him doing that, turnover declined sharply on all his lines. Profits went from $30 million a year to $160 million in just 2 years. Living wage cut down on turnover, which built the country's and company's strength, strengthened the surrounding community, put more money in the pockets of Ford workers, gave them a chance to purchase more vehicles, and more people went to work. Nonetheless, the Wall Street Journal at the time screamed headlines saying that this brought, quote, biblical or spiritual principles into a field where they do not belong, end of quote. And you say, well, how would they say that? Well, that was back in the teens, in the 1900s. Well, folks, does this sound familiar? A couple weeks ago, Ken Langhorne, who I don't know, a billionaire founder of Home Depot, predicted that the Pope Francis' critique of income inequity will be, quote, a hurdle for very wealthy Catholic donors who seem to think hurt feelings trump the teachings of the Bible. As a practicing Catholic, bless me, Father, for he has sinned. I mean, come on. Come on. What are we talking about today? They've been saying this for a long time. But the fact is, income inequity distorts the economy. It has an overwhelming negative impact on the middle class, and that has an overwhelming impact on economic viability of the United States. In 1973, when I was sworn in as a 29, I just had turned 30, 30-year-old senator, the discrepancy between the salary of the average CEO and the lowest paid worker in their company was on average 22.1 to 1. So that is the lowest paid person in the corporation, relative to the CEO got 22 times what the lowest person paid. There's a reason to that. That's not unreasonable. You know what it is today? 273 to 1. 273 to 1. That's not to say having a brilliant CEO doesn't have a whole hell of a lot to do with the growth of your company. And in turn, the security of the workers. But on average, 273, and in some cases, 1,500 to 1. Folks, when we let wages get so far out of line with productivity, there used to be a deal. You guys got increases in direct proportion to the productivity because you were given credit for increasing productivity. You worked harder. Company made more money, you got a proportional share of that. It was just an understanding, a simple, basic understanding that prevailed. Now, admittedly, technology has gotten in the way because some of the productivity is totally a consequence of technological change, nothing that you or I have done. But 270 to 1? Folks, again, I get criticized for saying this. We're breaking a basic bargain, a bargain that built the greatest economic expansion in the history of the world. And that is workers, whether they're union or not, get to reap some of the benefits that they help produce. Simply put, we really are. This is not a campaign slogan. It's a reality. We are stronger when we grow from the middle out. We are the strongest nation in the world in large part because we have the largest, most stable middle class in the world. It affects political stability. Look, all the programs for the poor, they wouldn't exist without the consent of the middle class. They wouldn't exist for that, but for that. All the things that we value, it provides the social stability for the nation. And by the way, let me define what I mean by middle class. I got a lot of brilliant economists that work for me, and you do too. And they'll argue about where the middle class is 49,870 or 51,210. Middle class is a value set. Middle class means being able to own your home, not just rent it. Be able to send your kid to a park you can do safely and not worried about them getting mugged or beaten up. Being able to send them to a school where if they do well, they got a chance to get to college. And if they have a chance to get to college or to any school after high school, you'll be able to have a chance to get them there. And in the meantime, you'll be able to take care of your geriatric parents, and you hope and pray your children will never have to take care of you. Where I come from, that's middle class. That's not asking a whole hell of a lot. That has been the basic American dream. And no matter what neighborhood you're from, you were taught by your parents. In this country, you can be anything you want to be. Anything at all if you work hard. Just give me a chance. Don't give me a hand up. Give me a chance. I got so mad the last campaign when one of the candidates you're running against talked about how, you know, when I worked at McDonald's, I had dreams. If that Hispanic kid next to him doesn't have dreams. As if the guys I grew up with in Claymont didn't have dreams. I was raised in a house where my mother and father, who never went to college, said, I can be anything I want, including vice president or president of the United States of America. Look, folks. If I made this speech to you 25 years ago, it'd be legitimate to say, this guy's being demagogic. But today, how many parents do you know? I could say what my father said. The reason we moved from Scranton to Wilmington, Delaware, was there were no good jobs in 1953 in Scranton when I was in third grade. So he said, Joey, I'm going to leave for a year. I'm going to go with Uncle Frank in Wilmington. There are good jobs down there. It's growing. I'll come home every weekend. But I promise, honey, it's going to be okay. He believed it. He didn't doubt it. He believed it. And therefore, we believed it. How many parents you know today who feel absolute confidence to turn to their kid today and say, honey, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. Folks, that's what this is all about. In this country, if average Americans don't have the confidence, even when in hard times, to be able to turn to the kid and say, honey, it's going to be okay, and believe it's going to be okay, then we got a problem. And we have a problem. When that happens, when the middle class grows, the wealthier get wealthier, and there's a ladder up. The rest of industry has to take a lesson from ironically, the automobile industry, where you guys, through misfortune, management and labor had to cooperate to save an iconic industry. We get a lot of credit, Barack and me, and I get a lot of credit because everybody knows my view about automobiles and automobile manufacturing. Well, it was the president who made the decision to take a bet. Remember what we said, we're taking a bet on American auto workers. We're betting our presidency on it, we're betting the economy on it, and we're betting on the fact that management ingenuity still has enough ingenuity left to make it happen. So, folks, here's what happens. I was recently at the Detroit Auto Show. I'm a junkie. But I had an opportunity to speak to, I don't know how many people, 300, 400, 500 people, labor, management, dealers, et cetera, before I went out on the floor. And I pointed out that although we provided Barack and me, the administration, provided the mechanism to rescue the auto industry. It was the cooperation between labor and management that saved it, and no one, I'm reminded the management was there. No one gave more at the office to rescue the industry than labor. You made incredible sacrifices. 21,000 layoffs at General Motors, 6,000 layoffs at Chrysler, 21 Chrysler plant closures, wage freezes for employees at General Motors, reduction in health care benefits for retirees, and a new bargain you signed on to, all to save an iconic industry, the automobile industry, which is synonymous with the United States of America. And by the way, in the process, you saved a million jobs, other jobs. Don't take my word for it. Every time I say that, my Republican friends say that. It was Keith Hennessy, director for President Bush's National Economic Council, who said back in 2008, quote, 1.1 million jobs will be lost in the near future if automotive makers were suddenly liquidated. So look what you did. But thanks to you, since Chrysler and General Motors have emerged from bankruptcy along with the efforts of Ford, you've added 380,000 jobs instead of hemorrhaging 500,000 jobs. $8,300 new jobs in last December alone. And there's more to come. There's still more to do. It's not just about coming back. It's about taking a larger and larger share of the market back. It's about outproducing in foreign markets as well. It's about making, as my dad would say, product. Product. My dad never owned a dealership. My dad never had a lot of money, but he ran two dealerships in the state of Delaware for 35 years. And he used to always say, Joey, all they got to do is send me product. Just send me product. Well, guess what? You're sending product. You're sending product just as the Detroit Auto Show showed. And I don't have to tell you that. And the reason why you're sending product, look at the pride you personally on the line are taking in the automobile that you're stamping made in America. Look at the, now I mean this sincerely. Look at, I remember the fights we used to have back in the 70s and the early 80s at the General Motors plant and the Chrysler plant about giving you more authority to stop the line if a car was, I mean, you know, it was like, you don't know anything. Well, guess what? They figured out you know a whole hell of a lot. And they figured out, no, I mean it sincerely. They figured out they make a better product when you're in the deal. When you're in the deal, for the first time ever, both the North American truck and car of the year from General Motors, the Chevy Silverado and the Stingray. The year before that, the Cadillac ATS took home the honor, plus luxury car of the year. Look at Ford. The F-150, 700 pounds lighter, aluminum frame, increased fuel efficiency. But the really good news is 4,300 jobs at River Rouge and more to come. And have you seen the new Chrysler 200? Designed and priced to compete with the Toyota Camry and the Honda Accord? We're coming, folks. We're coming. It had enough. That little Chrysler 200 had enough horsepower to bring back 900 jobs at Sterling Heights. Now look, I know some of you make Chryslers, some of you make Fords, but if you excuse a point of personal privilege, I still have my 67 Corvette. By the way, my grown sons had it rebuilt for me, and it costs 7 times the sticker price to rebuild it. But it's a quarter horse, man. That's all it is, a quarter horse. But that new Stingray, yo. Oh, it's more than a quarter horse, even though it can go 0 to 60 in 3.9 seconds. Not that I like speed. It also can track on a curve. It has 106.7-inch wheelbase. It has more weight in the back for the first time ever. And I could hardly wait if I were just not in this job to take on my friend's Porsche. I'm serious. It's the best buy in America. You know, Motor Trend says it snaps back to center and lets you hold the car through any corner. I can hardly wait. You know, by the way, you guys, everyone wants to know whether or not I'm going to run for president. There's a lot of reason to run for president, but there's one overwhelming reason not to run for president. I'd like to get that Z06 with 0 to 60 in 3.4 seconds. 3.4 seconds. You tack that sucker up to $6,000 and it comes out of the hole like a bullet, man. The press is, I'm going to say it anyway. I was talking to the chairman of the General Motors and I said, God, I'd love to drive this sucker. And I said, the only place they let me drive is on the test track of the Secret Service, so maybe we could arrange to have one there. I may ask. But look, all kidding aside, the biggest news is you guys are part of the mix again. You guys are into quality control. You guys can actually press a button and bring the line to a halt if you see a problem. You know there's a reason why these vehicles are so much better. And you take pride once again in the fact that you're building these suckers. Union pride. Union pride. Because guess what? If it goes off the line, it has your name on it. And like I said, it's working. 380,000 new jobs. The big three have come out of a low of about 13 million vehicles sold worldwide in 2009. We were being told by all the experts you'd have to be in a position where you can't expect more than 13 million ever to be sold worldwide again. You got to drop that number. In 2013, 18 million American vehicles sold worldwide. U.S. exports went from $25 billion in 2009 to $51 billion in 2012. You build a better product with better mileage. The legislation we passed, you guys used to be mad at me. The one place we used to have arguments about is CAFE standards. I was right, y'all were wrong. And let me tell you, we doubled the mileage requirement. You guys built the vehicles that do it, and guess what? You're selling them on a global market. You're competing now. American trucks and cars are competitive in every market. Folks, let me just say it this way. You guys at the UAW not only saved the auto industry, you saved the heartbeat of American manufacturing. It really is hard. So think about this. I'm not being nice. It's hard to imagine that we would have recovered had the industry gone under, not just you, we, the country, would have recovered had the industry gone under and we lost those million additional jobs. But the industry's back, and it's time for overall labor, for unions to come back, because manufacturing's coming back. You know, I said 5 years ago and got banged around for it, I said, I predict, just as your kids and we heard the word outsourcing constantly, that our kids are going to hear the word insourcing. And everybody said, that's malarkey. But guess what? It's not. Manufacturing is coming back to the United States, and let me tell you why. You know why, but I want the public to remember why. It's coming back for a number of reasons. One, North America in the second decade of this century, in the third decade, is going to become the energy epicenter of the world, not the Arabian Peninsula, North America. That's a fact, by the way. We're going to be energy independent by 2032, North America energy independent by the 20s. And that's one of the reasons why. Manufacturing is coming home. Natural gas is somewhere between 5 and 14 times cheaper in the United States than it is in Europe and in Asia. Guess what? The second reason they're coming back. American intellectual property is protected. They're tired of going to China, and not only China, but other places, and having their intellectual property, that means the thing which they produced, stolen from them. But you know the biggest reason why? And this is not hyperbole, this is the fact. American workers are 3 times as productive as Chinese workers. 3 times. Now, here's what that means. Here's what that means. That means that back when in China, they were paying 95 cents an hour, as they began to grow, guess what? They found out what happens in America. People demand more. They're now making about $5 an hour. That means even if they only pay three times that amount, we can still outcompete anybody paying 15 an hour. And we can outcompete anybody paying $25 an hour because we're so much more productive. It's our intention to keep it that, keep them coming home. There's only one way to make that happen, is to make sure we have the most skilled workforce in America. Just as you guys have figured out, and you're way ahead in your apprenticeship programs and all that you've done with the industry, making the new Ford, the new Chrysler, the new General Motors vehicle is a hell of a lot more complicated than it was before. It requires more technological skill than before. And you've trained yourselves up to be able to do it. But that's why the president asked me to head up this task force he talked about in the State of the Union, that message. When the whole purpose of this is to widen the aperture for access to the middle class. The problem is, the last 20 years, it's just been getting narrower and narrower and narrower. Now, all these companies that are coming home, right now, for example, there's 100,000 high-tech jobs, high-tech manufacturing jobs outside the auto industry in the United States of America that are going unfilled. Because guess what? And all that outsourcing, all of you who live in the upper Midwest and the Pennsylvania, Delaware, where I'm from, how many factories did you see padlocked? They picked up the machinery and everything, and it took it abroad beginning in the 70s. Well, guess what? The guy who used to be a skilled welder, a machinist, etc. His son or daughter comes along and says, Dad, I want to be a machinist. He says, like hell you're going to be a machinist. Like hell you're going to be a welder. There's no future there. Well, guess what? Now these outfits are coming back. They're coming back, and they don't have the skilled personnel. They don't have people trained in photovoltaic technology, which is a big new thing. They don't have people working in a lot of these areas. And we have to deal with the long-term unemployment. Commerce Secretary Pritzker is doing a great job. She met with over 800 business leaders so far, 70 of the Fortune 500 CEOs. He asked them what their needs are and how we can prepare the people to meet those needs. In particular, we asked them to change their HR practices, their hiring practices, to not just automatically discard anybody who's been unemployed for more than 6 months to a year, and make a commitment to us they'll hire a percentage of those people, because it's a cancer in a society. When hardworking people have worked all their whole life and can't do anything, and once they reach a point where they've been unemployed for a certain amount, there's no prospect of getting back. Another way is to take a page out of American Labor and the apprenticeship programs. We're watching what you're doing in job apprenticeship programs at the Ford plants across the country, offering Ford employees the opportunity to improve their skills and get higher paying jobs in trades such as electrical work and welding. Over 23,000 workers have completed the four-year program, earning $59,000 as an apprentice and $68,000 when they complete the program. That's part of the future. If the UAW apprenticeship program works for welders and electricians, why not computer engineers? Why not healthcare workers? We need to build a ready supply of high-tech manufacturing workers. We need to do it right now. Look, folks, as I said, there's 100,000 jobs out there right now waiting for the qualified people. We're trying to connect them with the community colleges, get the companies in there to train these folks and tell them, what do you need? What specific skill do you need? Bring your machines inside the community college. That number is going to grow to 875,000 people needed for these new skills. That's why we put together a program that provides the funding for these colleges. Reach out to manufacturers, bring in, tell us exactly what you need, and we'll train them for the exact need you have if you'll go ahead and hire them. Look, folks, there's so much more to talk about here, and I've already talked too long to you. I apologize. But let me, I said it to you 4 years ago, and I'll say it again. I predict, just as you and I constantly heard the phrase outsourcing, we're going to hear the phrase insourcing. But we have to have the most qualified workforce in America. Over 50% Over 50% of all manufacturing executives surveyed by the Boston Consulting Group said they are actively looking to bring back jobs from China to the United States of America. 50%. 50%. Now look, folks, we got to keep our eye on the ball. We have to organize. We have to fight back in these unrelenting efforts to continue to diminish collective bargaining, because at the end of the day, it's going to rest upon our ability, American workers' ability, to collectively bargain. Some of what we call collective bargaining may change. I'm not going to talk about it, but what's going on in Tennessee, it's a different method, but a method, an important method. We have to change. We have to adapt. We have to adapt, but what we can't lose sight of is the moment workers cannot be represented by an organization that has the opportunity to bargain for their work conditions and their salaries. That's the moment we're owned. That's the moment when it's over. That's the moment when all the leverage goes out. So there's a tremendous opportunity for American workers. And we have to continue this fight on income inequality. And we got to do it with you. I'm in this. I'm in this up to my ears, as is the president. And whether I held office or didn't held office, I ain't going away, because this is too important to my kids, my grandkids, and their kids. We have to be vigilant and unrelenting in our fight to protect and expand collective bargaining. On that, if we yield, and guys, I know it looks pretty dim right now, but guess what? This too shall pass. No, and I mean it. The American people, at their core, have never, ever, 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 ever let their country down. Given a chance, they have never failed to understand the most essential things that are needed for their well-being. And I predict to you, if we're smart, if we're unrelenting, it'll become clearer and clearer to the American people as these efforts of unrelenting attempts to undermine our ability to collectively bargain become more apparent. We will gain more and more and more and more help from people who never thought about unions. The American people, united all workers, have always ended up choosing the right way in the end. We go sometimes two steps forward and one back, but we always end up going forward. That's the history of the journey of this country. You led the way before. I'm counting on you leading the way again. I love you guys. God bless you all, and may God protect our troops.